pick something. Yeah. And also share for the very extent. Okay. Good morning. Today we are going to continue with the lecture what we have just covered in the morning period. Essentially, we started with longitudinal dynamics, wherein we have looked at a free body diagram of a passenger car, and we derived an expression for maximum traction that can be developed at the tire road interaction in terms of road adhesion coefficient and vehicle parameters. That's very important because this is one of the parameters that's going to decide the vehicle performance characteristics. Also, we have ended the class stating that this is not only sufficient, also you have to look at what is that driving torque that comes from the engine to the driven wheels and the corresponding tractive effort because of that also to be looked at. So either of this would decide the capability of your vehicle to accelerate or to brake or to negotiate a grade. So this depends upon smaller of value of both of this. That's what is our understanding. We just stop, and I'm going to discuss now the additional on the next the other power plant and transmission characteristic cases at the moment. So let me share for the purpose my board. Just back again. So are you able to look at the board? Yeah. So
yes, sir.
Yeah, this free body diagram is what we looked at, and we derived the equation for maximum tractive effort for a case of a rear wheel drive vehicle as well as for a case of a front wheel driven vehicle. And you see here this Roman letter 1 equation. So this is what is coming from engine. So what is M subscript E is engine torque. So engine torque into overall reduction ratio into mechanical efficiency from the engine to the wheel transmission system divided by the rolling radius. So this is rolling radius of the tire. Decides again an FX value. So this FX value and this FX value, smaller of that decides the vehicle capability is what we have looked at it. So now today's lecture number 15, we are going to look at in detail power plant and transmission characteristics. So as you know, as we have concluded in the previous lecture, the two points. One is what is that maximum tractive effort developed at the tire road interaction that can support the capability. Other one is this power plant characteristics. So here you see, I have written the title of this lecture is not only power plant characteristics, also transmission characteristics. And transmission characteristics. You understand why this go together is because what is an ideal power, speed, characteristics for a vehicle or vehicular application for that sake, application. If I ask you the question, everyone would say that I require a constant power. So if I take, this is my speed axis. And if I take power requirement for the vehicle, power requirement it is. If you look at that, power has to be constant. That's what we will expect for the vehicular application. But you see now, on the other hand, the power speed characteristics of an IC engine, right? So this is requirement. You see that most of the vehicles are either gasoline engine or diesel engine. So if we consider an IC engine, say gasoline engine, mounted a vehicle, a passenger car, the power speed characteristics, say here I have up to say some 100 kilowatts power. It is not constant. It is varying. Maybe the speed of the operating speed of my vehicle, if I look at, I will have that speed now. No, in general, you would see for a passenger car application, it will be say some 2000 RPM here. So I am just not considering below the speed. You will understand why in a while. This is 600 RPM. So revolutions per minute. So if I consider my power plant power versus speed characteristics is not constant like this. It is going to vary something like this. And then it falls. So it is going to be like this. So how can then this IC engine can provide me constant power? That's what is the question now that comes. That can be possible if I have an appropriate transmission system. So with the help of this transmission system, I'm able to have my power plant characteristics equal to that of, say, if it provides a constant power, correct? So let us also look at, you know, how we define a power is nothing but it is torque into omega, torque times omega. So if I have my ideal requirement of power for vehicular application, my torque and omega variation should be how? This is speed. I can write in terms of omega also here. So, and in terms of RPM, so I have my speed variation if you look at. And that is going to be varying hyperbolically like this. Right? That means what? At a lower speed, I would have a maximum torque. At higher speeds, I will have a minimum torque requirement so that I would be able to have this product as constant. So, this is what is an ideal expected power speed or attractive or torque, power torque speed characteristics. So why I have put here a torque, this is what is torque. So the torque divided by the rolling radius multiplied by appropriate overall reduction ratio and efficiency. What is that I have? I have my tractive effort. So the tractive effort would be maximum required or more required at lower speed. At higher speed, it may not be required that much. So this is that kind of ideal requirement. But this ideal requirement now have to be obtained from here. So that is what we are discussing. This is the reality of an IC engine. So power speed characteristic is not constant. It varies and it goes to a maximum value and then again it is dropping at a particular speed. And if you look at another hand, what is the variation of the torque in an engine? So for that purpose, let me have a scale here that goes from, I'm taking a scale on this, that varies from say 200 Newton meter to that is the upper value and 160 Newton meter. So a typical car can have a torque variation from 160 Newton meter to 200 Newton meter. So the variation of the torque, if you look at, that's going to be something like this. So I will have a smaller value initially torque and that goes to some maximum value and then it's going to drop and the drop will be so drastic after that. So this is what is the torque variation of a gasoline engine. So how this is going to be mapped or from this I'm going to obtain this is what is because of the appropriate transmission system. So the transmission system would take care of that so that I would be able to have my requirement of ideal power, torque, speed characteristics, right? So this is on one hand. On the other hand, you look at, we know this is that demerit of the shortcoming of IC engine, but why they are popular and they are mostly employed in vehicular application? Why is because, what are the advantages, can anyone say? What are the reasons why you have this IC engines are employed? IC engines are employed?
High power to weight ratio.
Very good, very good. So the first point, if you look at the high power to weight ratio, so I can extract the high power at the smaller weight of the engine. So high power to weight ratio, that is first point. Are there any other point that to add? This can provide good fuel efficiency. Good fuel efficiency, good fuel economy to meet, that's possible. And relatively low cost. Because to have this, see, this kind of characteristics that we can readily look at in an electric motor, series wound electric motor, power speed characteristic is this. So that is also one of the reason why nowadays at e-mobility, replacing IC engine by electric motors become very popular. And another mode of power plant is electric mobility. And that is going to minimize or that is going to replace the requirement of transmission. So these are all some of the advancement in the power plant technology for vehicular application. But however, currently our past decades and another future 2-3 decades also, the application of IC engine is not going to suddenly disappear. And we are living in this state of IC engine application vehicles, the maximum. So we have to have an attention and understanding the reason for why they are applied. So that is what we are stacking here one by one. So it is relatively less cost, low cost, and it is easy to start. And another important thing is that there are legislative norms that imposes emission norms. So the engine technology has been now under more researched so that the emission that comes out of these engines are reduced to the maximum extent possible. There are many research that is going on, and that is another reason why this has become more popular. So less emission. So earlier it is more emission engine, but this research on control of emission or reduction in emission is becoming a stronghold in this field of development of engine. So less emission is also another reason why IC engines are more popular. So how these emissions are reduced? If you look at in a research, I just to brief it, you can get this as a project. You can go and read the literatures, right? So there are two approaches. One is reduce the emission by having control at the emission combustion itself, where that emission are forming, prevent them from forming. So improper combustion is what is going to give you more carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, or more particulates that can come and harm the environment. So have a control on there itself. So what is the control? The control is make the fuel to burn completely. So how are these achieved? That is what is by direct fuel injection concept or lean burn combustion concept. You make your air fuel ratio such that it is a lean mixture, so that the complete combustion has been taking place and so on. So this would make your emission that comes out can be reduced. Or another approach is have a control or remove them after the combustion before that is been allowed to the exhaust. allowed to the environment. So what do? You have this pollutant to remove. There are mechanisms. So inject an air, right, into the exhaust manifold of the engine, so that the air will make sure that the unburnt fuel can be burnt, and then there won't be any pollutant that comes out. So such technology, or catalytic converter employed in the exhaust system and so on. So these are all some of the advancements that you see, apart from the first four listed advantages of the engine. Today's IC engine technology is able to meet the legislative requirement of less pollution because of an advanced research that goes in that place. Apart from that, also nowadays the fuel for this engine is an another aspect. Apart from this gasoline or diesel, fossil fuels, you also have an alternative fuels research. So you have this alternative fuels with a compressed natural gas such as LPG, can also reduce the less pollution on the pollutant. So if you see that alternative fuel, especially along with the LPG, it is also improving vibration noise characteristics. There are some advantages. There are many research that is going on in that front as well. So keeping this all in mind, if you look at it, is not only ending with the IC engine technology with your petrol engine or diesel engine. Primarily they are working with the constant volume cycle or constant pressure cycle or combination and so on, or the basic thermodynamic cycle. There are other thermodynamic cycles are also being exploited to get to the engine technology, such as Rankine cycle or Stirling cycle and so on, right? Gas turbine engines, where gas turbine engine you have the thermodynamic cycle is different. So these are all some of the other research that has been going on in the power plant technology side. You see, today, Sarah, we talk on complete zero emission to the environment, and very low noise and vibration in the vehicle. The e-mobility taking an upper hand. There are many OEMs already had come out with their first version or second version of electric vehicles. And you also see the hybrid vehicle technology and so on. So these are all something that we talk on the power plant side, what is that current scenario. And you see the vehicle operated with electric vehicle operated not only with the electric motors and battery technology, and it is also being operated with the fuel cells technology. So you know what do you mean by fuel cells? Fuel cells are, it's a device which is basically an electrochemical device, wherein chemical reaction has been converting harvesting electrical power to drive your motors and so on. So this all on one hand, on the power plant, that we should be aware, the conventional gasoline engine or diesel engine is having its hold still on vehicular application, though the discussed or shortcoming through this power speed or torque speed characteristic that you see. Why? Because you would be able to convert this shortcoming into the ideal power requirement by means of employing transmission. So this with the transmission would give you this. So that is what is that we are going to see. So now let us just go ahead looking at what are this, what is this engine characteristics, slightly more detailed. So if you look at the speed I have shown here, suppose say some 2000 RPM, maybe this is what is called an idle speed. So where the vehicle will, engine will run smoothly. So till then the engine for the load that is having, it won't run smoothly. So engine running, running smoothly at a speed called an idle speed. And then you see that good combustion quality And maximum torque, look at the maximum torque that is happening where? Some intermediate speed, some speed say here some 3000 or 3500 RPM. So at some intermediate speed, I have maximum torque. That's all why, because you look at another important parameter called specific fuel consumption. So let us take another scale here for the speed, and that will be representing specific fuel consumption from 0.25 upper value to 0.02 something here. So I would see that the specific fuel consumption will be lower here, and then it goes up like this. So the fuel consumption also is very less at an intermediate speed. So when you are operating at this speed, you would be able to have maximum torque, and it is also not corresponding to the maximum power just before only it comes. So the power, maximum power reaches to the speed which is higher than that speed of the engine, right? It goes to the speed where you have a maximum power, and then it drops. And the dropping of power is because of the torque start dropping sharply after a particular speed. So this is happening. So why is this torque has to drop so suddenly is because of mean effective pressure in the engine decreases. Why the mean effective pressure in the engine decreases as the crankshaft rotates? It is all because of the losses that takes place in air induction manifold of the engine. So these are all something in engine technology or an engine course, IC engine subject, no, you could have studied. So this is what is this characteristics. So with this, now let us move on to looking at what is the transmission side, right? I'm going to now look at more of transmission side. So you have any question, any point at this moment to ask?
Yes, so what does the green line on the graph indicate?
Yeah, that is specific fuel consumption. So what is specific fuel consumption? Can anyone say? Specific fuel consumption. What is the unit of specific fuel consumption? What is the unit of specific fuel consumption? Mass of the?
Yeah, mass upon power.
Mass of the fluid for power. Kilowatt hour. What is that is specific fuel consumption? Specific fuel consumption is fuel consumption kilo kg per kilowatt. Specific fuel consumption divided by again the time. So kg per kilowatt hour is what is specific fuel consumption. That is going to be reflecting on a fuel economy of your engine. So that is achievable in the intermediate speed itself. Like that you are able to see. So at that intermediate speed. Right? So that value of that is what I just have put an example value. It's varying from specific fuel consumption. So I put it for a diesel engine. So this value, say for this typical one, is upper value is 0.32 and lower value is 0.28. So 0.28 kg per kilowatt hour to 0.32 kg per kilowatt hour. So I just have put this is what is nature of an IC engine. But this does not provide actually what is that is required for vehicular application. This is requirement for a vehicular application. So this requirement can be easily, the low cost can be met by an appropriate transmission system. So we are going to look at this transmission system. So this transmission system, what is it composed of? It is a mechanical system. So engine output shaft would be connected to a transmission system or to a gearbox through a clutch. So the gearbox will have number of gears in a particular fashion arranged. So that you would be able to extract the variation of speeds at the output of the gearbox. So I have an engine speed. I want to have the same speed as an output of a gearbox. I can have a direct drive. I can also have the same speed. Instead of that, I want to have a reduction in that. I can also have an arrangement of gears such that so I can have a lowest speed. So that is my high reduction ratio also is possible. So you can have different reduction ratios. I want to drive my vehicle at high speeds. I can do that. I want to drive my vehicle at low speeds to extract maximum torque, I can do that. So that's all possible through a transmission. And the engine is connected to a gearbox, and the gearbox in turn has got a propeller shaft, and the other end of the propeller shaft is been with a differential, and the differential is connected to a drive axle, and the drive axle at the ends you have your wheels of a rear wheel drive vehicle, front engine mounted rear wheel drive vehicle. So that is a typical vehicle that we look at it. So in such a transmission, how this various speeds that is achievable is what we have to see. That can be achieved through a manual transmission system, that can be achieved through an automatic transmission system with an application of torque converter, and that can also be achieved by variable speed, continuously varying speed transmission system, and also something called a hydrostatic transmission system. So CVT, hydrostatic transmission, there are many types of transmission system that can be witnessed in the vehicle technology, right? So on today's class, I'm going to look at the manual transmission system, how that manual transmission system can meet to get such a kind of ideal performance nature is what I'm going to explain you in another 25 to 30 minutes. Right, any doubt at the moment you have? You know what is transaxle? Let me ask you some of the question. What is let me ask this question. What is transaxle?
Yes.
AXLE. What is transaxle?
Sir, gearbox and differential in a single unit.
So when the transmission and the differential are integrated into a single unit, it's known as the transaxle.
Yes, yeah. So when that can happen?
Usually it is found in our hatchback front wheel driven cars because of the space constraints.
Okay. The hatchback vehicles have your front engine mounted and you have your driven axle also in the front axle. So in such cases, you would avoid your propeller shaft and you would have straight away your engine output is given to the gearbox, and the gearbox and the differential all put together as one unit called transaxle. So that would happen normally if your engine mounted in the front and the front wheel drive vehicle, and if you have your engine mounted at the rear and the rear wheel drive vehicle, it would happen. So you would have your propeller shaft eliminated and you'll have your transaxle. You rightly said that. So that's one thing that you should know when we talk about transmission. And there is another thing. What is overdrive gear? Can anyone say what is overdrive gear?
The speed of the vehicle will be more than the speed of the engine, sir. That means the gear ratio will be less than one.
Gear ratio will be less than one.
Yes, sir.
Overdrive. Look at why is it called overdrive.
Sir, the gear at which output speed is greater than input speed.
Yeah. So whatever the output speed of the engine that comes, you see your vehicle speed is more than that. That is what is called overdrive gear, right? Overdrive gear. So you would see where are these overdrive gear, why is this overdrive gear is employed. So it's basically in the gearbox, the highest gear. So overdrive gear would be highest gear. So you can have your highest gear in your gearbox is the direct drive gear is called. What do you mean by direct drive gears? Whatever the output speed of my engine, that should be the speed of my drive axle. If that comes, that is my highest speed that is I am able to achieve. But still, you have an option of the option that though my engine output speed is say some RPM, I can have more RPM than that in my drive axle by providing overdrive gears, right? That's what is called overdrive gears. You have vehicles with overdrive gears where you see the reduction ratio is greater than one. Someone said less than one. So you need to have that clear understanding. Okay, then what is final drive? Can anyone say what is final drive? What is final drive?
Differential to wheel.
What is final drive?
Differential crown and pinion.
What is it?
Differential pinion. Crown and pinion.
Differential crown and pinion. Okay. See, when I say drive or transmission, it is made of shafts mounted with gears. We have studied in mechanics of material course in undergraduate topics on this gears and on gear trains. So you see different gear trains, simple gear train, reverted epicyclic gear train and so on. There are varieties of gear trains. So this all understanding would help you to have your arrangement of gears with an appropriate number of intermediate shafts so that you are able to play around with that input speed and what is that your output speed and so on to get. So I'm not going to go in more detail of taking one gearbox of a vehicle and look at how the gears are arranged and so on. That's not the objective of my lecture at the moment. I'm just wanting to have knowledge. Now, these are something that we witness and required when you look at how can the transmission helps in meeting the required ideal power speed characteristic or torque speed characteristic. For that purpose only, I'm having this lecture. So in that part, if you look at final drive, it's just something opposite to that of overdrive gear in the vehicle. So final drive is final reduction that's possible for them. So I have the smallest speed in my vehicle. I have to have my engine gives you high speeds, but what is always preferred in case of an engine? I wanted my engine to run between a constant range of speed, operating in a constant range of speed. I can't have my engine speed come to zero while gears are engaged. So that would happen when sudden overload or something come, and then it will stall the engine. Engine will be stopped because of overload. So I have to operate always in a particular range of speed, my engine. And I should be able to get my vehicle speed accordingly, right? So if I have that in mind, I have to have this. So there will be a highest, lower gear, if I say it's the first gear. So what is the first gear means? It is the highest reduction possible gear. Higher gear, highest gear means what? I have five gears in my vehicle. So fifth gear would be the highest gear. So that is going to be direct drive, or it can be corresponding to overdrive of my vehicle, right? So at the lowest gear, where highest reduction possible is not sufficient, supposing in a particular case of a vehicle, I wanted further reduction, then I can have something called a final drive, that's crown and pinion arrangement in the wheel, in the drive axle. So further I can get it reduced. So that is what is called the final drive. So that you know now. So now if you look at this gearbox, an important element. So the gearbox for a car, passenger cars, can have variation in speeds output. See, gearbox is going to give an output. So I'm not, though I have my engine, I'm going to depend on the output of my gearbox. So when I take an output of the gearbox, that is what is my ideal speed requirement. That's going to help me to meet the ideal power or torque speed characteristics. So in a gearbox for a car, passenger car, if you look at, that can vary from 3 to 5 gear speeds. Whereas in a case of a heavy vehicle or commercial vehicles, if you look at, that can vary from 5 to minimum 5 to some 16 gears reduction. Such a big possibilities are there in a commercial vehicle. So if you look at now, how are these gears are selected? How are these gears are decided? That means that is what is very important question that comes in our mind, right? So how are these decided? So for that, let me just have how this overdrive gear or the direct drive gear. right? So vehicle can have direct drive or overdrive gear. So how can I decide my direct drive possibility from the engine output? And how can I have my final drive, that is at the lower speed? And then how can I have my intermediate speed? So if I have my vehicle with the 5 gears of passenger car or 4 gears of my passenger car, then first gear is going to provide me like a final drive or the first gear or the highest reduction possible. So what is the basis to decide that speed output of the gearbox? And fifth gear is the highest gear. So it will provide me the smallest reduction, not smallest reduction, it's a direct drive or maybe overdrive possibility at my driven axle. So what is the basis to decide this higher gear? How do I decide my intermediate gears in a manual transmission system is what that I have to see, right? So for that purpose, now I'm going to explain you with us some important equations so that you would connect your understanding very well. So those equations are not new to us. Let's just look at those equations now, right? Okay, so let me write an equation and decide on how are we going to see. So in the morning only we have looked at two important equations. I am writing it once again here is because with respect to power plant, right? Engine torque. So I know what is the maximum or the tractive effort that can be obtained from the driving torque on the wheels, right? What is it is from engine torque. And the zeta symbol is, what is the zeta symbol? Reduction ratio possible. What is the possible maximum reduction ratio? So the subscript not this overall reduction ratio, the overall reduction ratio of the transmission, right? What is that is possible? So overall reduction means this including gearbox and drive axle gear ratios all. And the efficiency, mechanical efficiency, which is divided by rolling radius of this. This is an important equation that you should look at it. So I'll just put the number 3.30 here is because this is the equation number in the Wong textbook. So you can just go back and look at this equation. So you know all the terms in this. So another important relation, what is the vehicle speed? What is my vehicle speed? So vehicle speed is given by engine speed. N subscript E is engine speed multiplied by rolling radius. So engine speed is in omega r omega is what is linear speed, and it has to be multiplied by a factor 1 minus I. What is this I? Can anyone say what is this I? That is your longitudinal slip, what you have seen, correct? Longitudinal slip. Because of this slip, what would happen? I is there, I would have my velocity is such that I may not get an equivalent translatory motion. So 1 minus I here in case of traction. 1 plus I means it is in case of braking. That is what you would see, right? But in this case, we are not looking at braking now. We don't have such equation. Braking speed reduces.
Car for other times.
This is slip, longitudinal slip, divided by what is that is the overall reduction ratio. So this is the equation number 331, you should remember, which is the corresponding vehicle speed. So I will have my traction that comes from an engine torque, is this match, would provide me the speed of the vehicle by this, right? So these are the two equation, you keep it in mind. Now let us look at how are we going to design this gearbox, the transmission, manual transmission system, to meet ideal power requirement. So for that, let me take N-speed gearbox. So what is zeta N now going to refer? It is the highest gear in the gearbox with the N-speed. So this is going to be the gear ratio of the highest gear in the end speed. Yes, boss. So if I have 5 means here 5 speed gearbox, 3 means 3 speed gearbox, 4 means 4 speed gearbox, like that you can say. So zeta n is what is the gear ratio of the highest gear in the n speed gearbox. If I consider, I can write this zeta n as given by ne1 subscript 1 r into 1 minus I divided by V max into zeta AX. So what is the zeta AX? It is very important. Look at this. What is the zeta AX? It is gear ratio of drive axle, which are there in your differential. Gear ratio of the drive axle. What is V max? Is the maximum vehicle speed that is possible. What is NE1 is an engine speed. R is your rolling radius of the tire. I is slip. So this is that equation that is going to be the basis for selecting the direct drive. Basis for selecting the direct drive. Also to find out what would be the corresponding axle gear ratio. So I decide what is my vehicle maximum speed of my vehicle. So if I have that maximum vehicle speed, and I, for the what is that engine speed that I fix, I would be able to find out what would be my drive axle reduction ratio, right? Because this I needed. So what would happen? My nth higher gear should be a direct drive. That's what we were been discussing. Direct drive. So if it is to be a direct drive, what does this has to be? This gear ratio has to be 1. So if I substitute zeta n is equal to 1. So this equation is going to help me to find out what is this drive axle gear ratio. So that's going to be, if this is 1, that's going to be simply ne, right? That's going to be NE1 R into 1 minus I by V max. So this is what is my drive axle AX. This is AX. Drive axle gear ratio. So the drive axle gear ratio is obtained generally in a gearbox considering highest gear first. And that value is equal to 1. So highest gear, how do you decide what is the required maximum vehicle speed? So maximum vehicle speed generally would be beyond the maximum speed. See, for example, look at here once again, this plot, what we had drawn, this plot. So if you look at, you see there is the maximum power. This is the maximum power point and the corresponding speed. But if you look at the vehicular application, the maximum speed of the engine is dictated not at this speed. It is the speed beyond this. So the engine speed, maximum engine speed of your engine in a vehicular application is decided 10 to 15% more than that of the speed of the engine at which you get a maximum power. So I don't have my engine operating below the maximum power point or at the maximum power point. I would always decide my maximum speed of my engine to be run at the speed which is beyond the speed corresponding to the maximum power point. Why is it? Because to provide overdrives. Why is it? Because to provide overdrives. So let me draw on another plot, you would understand that clearly, correct? Okay, so let me just go here back again in our discussion. So this is how you are going to decide your highest gear. So let me go ahead for deciding highest gear. So this is case one, or it is step one in manual gear transmission gearbox understanding. So highest gear you decide, it's a gear ratio to be 1, so that it can be overdrive or 1.1 or 1.15. If you are providing 10% overdrive or 15% overdrive or 1.3, if you provide 30% overdrive, put that here and you get your accordingly what is your drive axle gear ratio for the highest gear. And this is important. Why? Because this is what is going to be now useful in finding the lowest gear in your gearbox. That's step number two. Let me just put that here now. Step two, lowest gear. Lowest gear would provide what? Highest reduction ratio. So it is not a direct drive. So my engine speed would be more, output would be more. But what is that I should get at my drive axle will be very less speeds. So how do I decide that in a gearbox output should be of my lowest gear? So here zeta n, see, look at here the subscript n, because that is the highest gear on a n speed gearbox. So 5-speed gearbox means it is zeta 5, that's a fifth gear of my vehicle. So lowest gear now is going to be zeta 1. So how is it being decided, zeta 1? That is decided based on the highest torque requirement during grading of your vehicle. So I have to negotiate my grades. That's what we have looked at in the first morning lecture, right? So gradability. So when I say gradability, I would immediately recollect this. What is that? What is the basis to select this lower gear is what we are discussing. So in that, let's discuss. This is again for rear wheel drive vehicle. Rear wheel drive vehicle. We see we have derived in the morning F minus RR is what is the rest of the resistances, RA plus RD plus RG plus WA by G. So these are the resistances. So in this, what is this RG? You know, that is W sine theta S, that is grade resistant called. Grade resistance called. So what is that grade on the grade resistance? This theta S should be maximum now. So I have a maximum slope maybe corresponding to 33% of my grade. So tan theta S is equal to 0.33. So accordingly I get my angle. So that is what is going to be deciding now this lowest gear. So here you can see from this F minus RR. So what is my F? F is the maximum FX max. FX max, max, what is that we derived in terms of mu P and vehicle application is what is that you know. So I have to write it this. So W sine theta S max is going to be now F max minus F max minus. I can write this is F max minus RR. So what was my F max? It is mu PW by L into L1 minus H into FR by 1 minus mu PH by L. That's what we have seen in the morning for a rear wheel drive. Front wheel drive, this equation is different. So this minus FRW is what is this. Why I have not got these other terms? Because in a grade, you can't drive at a high speed when I have to have a grade which is of maximum grade that has to be negotiated. So if we go relatively very low speeds, and relatively very low speeds, this RA is neglected because this RA is given by half rho A V squared into CD. So in this, what is rho is the medium, air density. A is the projected area. V is the vehicle speed. And CD is what is called coefficient of drag. So determination of coefficient of drag, that's very involved experimental process. Either you have a proto type scale model of your vehicle or full scale vehicle, and you do have your wind tunnel test to calculate this CD. So you have this, and you see here the velocity square. So the resistance would be depending on the square of the speed. So the power requirement would be depending upon the cube of the speed. So at lower speed, this quantity can be neglected. High speeds, it's going to be very important. And RD is whenever you are towing. So you are not towing, so you can neglect it. And very low speeds, you have your acceleration value is very less. And you can also neglect this. So you have all together this. Now, I take this term on the other side and write my expression like this now. So when I do, so let me put this equation number so that you want to refer, you can refer. This is equation 3.26 in the textbook. So what would happen here? I would have my, this term is taken on the other side, and I have to write it for my zeta, right? So W sine theta S max plus FR into W is what is F max. What is F max? So this F max now is limited by engine. So I'm going to put this F max now by ME zeta 1. Look at here. Efficiency by R. Right? Morning that we have seen. So instead of overall efficiency, I'm going to design now the first gear of my gearbox. So if I equate this to this, I can get now my zeta 1. So, instead of this, it's not the zeta 1, it is going to be axle, AX, axle. So what is the axle speed? See, here you have R. So torque divided by R, that's the speed in the axle, the reduction ratio, gear ratio of the axle. It's not the zeta 1. So I should put this. So now I can have my zeta 1 as W sine equal to W sine theta S max plus FRW right by this. So this R goes up, and I have here ME, axle, and efficiency. So like this. So this is what is now to be known. So this is what is known from the highest gear, from the step one. Step one, we have got this. From step one, we have got this. So I can get now what is my zeta one. I can get my what is my zeta one, 3.27. So this is how the lower gear in the gearbox is decided, based on the gradability of your vehicle, grading capability of your vehicle, right? So highest gear is in the gearbox decided based on the highest speed that I wanted in my vehicle. And the lowest gear is what is decided based on the gradability, maximum gradability of my vehicle. And then intermediate gears are now, how are they decided? So they are based on the geometric progression in case of commercial vehicle, because you have many number of gears. But that is not the case in case of passenger cars. Why? Because to have a gears with an integer numbers, gear teeth with integers, it is very difficult when you have a smaller number of speeds in a gearbox. So you would see that will be varying. So the higher gears, if 5 gears gearbox means maybe 3-4 would be closer, and 1 and 2 will be varying. So they do not follow a geometric progression pattern. Why geometric progression pattern? Because the basic idea of intermediate gears are to operate at the same engine speed range. That's the basis. But in case of a heavy commercial vehicle, you are able to have that. You have a nice data available in your Wong textbook in a table form. What are the various gears and their corresponding gear reductions? You could witness overdrives and so on. right? So how do you decide now? Intermediate gears, that is my step number three. Step three, intermediate gears in the gearbox. So that is based on geometric progression. Right, that's based on geometric progression. What is geometric progression? Can anyone say? What do you mean by geometric progression? An is equal to a r raised to n minus 1. Right. So let's see that in a while. So how am I going to do? So for the same speed, operating speed range that I have to do, let me just take now two scales. Vertical scale is going to be my engine speed. Any and horizontal scale, I'm going to have my vehicle speed. Let's be right, vehicle speed. So now I'm going to decide my intermediate gears between a constant range of vehicle speed. So let me take NE1 and NE2, so two speeds. So NE1 is higher than that of NE2. This is smaller. So this range of speed, I can't rent the vehicle, or I can't get a speed with the one particular speed. There will be fluctuation of speed. Also, it is sometimes needed in case of agricultural application vehicle, tractor and all. If you see, you require the fluctuation of speed that comes, and that speed going beyond a particular speed should be prevented. So application of governor is there. So practically, you should have a variation cannot be eliminated. So you can have a range of speed for any of the vehicle speed. Any of the vehicle that I drive, my engine should run in this constant speeds, in this range of speed, instead of in this constant speed to say. So that is practically possible. So if I have that, let me have this limitation drawn by these two lines. And I have my maximum vehicle speed. See, if I consider N is equal to 4 gearbox. So 4 speed gearbox it is, right? It is called a 4 speed gearbox. So if I take that, I have my the highest speed given by V4. So V4, I have the highest speed. And that is achieved by this engine speed, NE1. If I have that, then the operating range, this is what is called an operating range. Range of engine speed. So I should first connect this because I have already decided on this. Right? I have my higher speed. So I have to connect this like this. So this is my fourth gear. Where till this, because I do not want the speed goes below. So I will have here a point which is going to intersect this range. So I decide the fluctuation from this engine speed, how much is permissible operating range. So if it is decided, there is a crossing of this speed. So this point is what is I am going to have my next speed. That is V3, next speed. So if I project this up, I will have my next line that comes here. So here, where it intersects the speed, lower operating range value, I will have my second speed in the gear box. So that is again extended here. Then I will connect this to this. And this is my V1. So that's my first gear. So you look at now the vehicle speed range here till V1 and then V2, then V3 and then V4, like this it goes. Correct? So this is how you have it called geometric progression. So this would give you what? The gear reduction ratio. So look at now, I have four gears. So zeta 2 by zeta 1 ratio is same as that of zeta 3 by zeta 2, same as that of zeta 4 by zeta 3. So the ratio of gear ratios, second gear ratio by first gear ratio, these ratios are constant. And that would be possible by this way if you are having your intermediate gear speeds decided by called geometric progression. So this all ratios, this is what is called the ratio of speeds. So what is this ratios essentially should give you? This operating speed range. So what is this operating speed range? I have now second gear to first gear. So this speed is more than this speed. This is, so this is more than this. So what is this here? I will have this ratio. It is going to be NE2 by NE1. So 2 by 1, 3 by 2, 4 by 3. So that's going to be NE2 by NE1. And that is going to be a factor kg. So this factor kg. If I have it like that, I can write now, this kg can be obtained by cubed root of this product, or not product, zeta 4 by zeta 1. So this 4 by 1, because these all are same, ratios are same. So I multiply same values by 3 times and take a cubed root. So if I do that, what will happen? Zeta 2 goes, zeta 3 goes, zeta 4 by zeta 1 that comes. So this is what is this factor you can find. And for a generalizing purpose, this kg can be written as, it's not nth root, n minus 1th root of n speed gear ratio. So it is zeta n by zeta 1, where this kg is what is can also be written as zeta n by zeta n minus 1. Like zeta 4 by zeta 3 I write, I would write this. So this is how you can generalize. So that's what I have written at the beginning. Right? Because you know this is decided first from the basis of highest speed. So I can just multiply this to have this. So I can also rewrite this with me. This kg factor, if I have, multiply that with the zeta n minus 1 to get this like that, right? So this is what is how your intermediate gears are, the speeds are decided. So any doubt in this discussion? So you have gear ratios for transmission of commercial vehicle given by table number, table 3.4 in your textbook. Wow. You can have from gear 1 to 16, you have this kg values given, right? Yeah. So I think I have finished manual gear transmission discussion. And if you have any doubts, you can ask. What is important here is that gearbox. So how this gearbox is going to provide finally your power requirement is like this. So I have at the first gear speed, I'll have its power characteristic like this. Second one, I'll have like this. Third one, I will have like this. And higher gears, I'll have like this. So enveloping of this. So this is going to go like this, not like this. So enveloping of this is going to give me my torque, or torque versus, or it's my tractive effort versus speed of my vehicle. So I would have here, so tractive effort here, you know, that is coming from engine means it is ME ratio eta E by R. So that is what I take it here. So I would have it like this. That's possible by means of having different speeds. Right, so this is one thing. And you also have to understand one other important thing. What is that is this overdrive all we have seen, but the engine has to not only to give you this required engine torque to get your tractive force, also the engine has to fulfill the power requirement for any other accessories like a cooling system, air conditioning system, exhaust system. So you have so many other system, power steering. So these all are required some power. So where are those power is coming from? That's all coming from engine. So engine has to provide some power to that. So there should be some reserve of the power. So you have to reserve the power. So the reservation of the power to have only, you have the condition of an operating speed of the engine goes beyond the speed corresponding to the maximum power of the engine. So that you need to understand. Let us again look at the power of the engine versus speed, road speed. Right, road speed is vehicle speed. Right, if you look at here, that would go like this. We have seen that goes to the max and comes. So your speed is not limited by this. You are taking somewhere here. So why is it? Because you see that power required to overcome vehicle resistances alone. We have seen in a vehicle there are various resistances, right? Aerodynamic resistance, rolling resistance, drawbar resistance, graded resistance, and all. So that all resistance to overcome, initially it will be smaller. After that, if you see, it will be increasing like this. So this is what is the requirement of power. This is all a requirement of power. Of power to overcome all external resistances. So this is your engine power. So if we have like this, then you have to have your overdrive. So from here I can have my overdrive. So I can have my overdrive means the power would be going like this. It will go like this. Another one, it will go like this. At the expense of reserve power. So in the first case, that power, so the average of this, if you look at somewhere here, so what is the power that is available over here is, this is the reserve power. And that would be reduces. That's fine. But you still have a reserve power. And these powers, whatever is reserved, would be required to accommodate sudden disturbances in the vehicle and so on. And these all are the power requirement for the external resistance. And here this resources for to accommodate other accessories power requirement and unexpected power requirements and so on. Right? See here, this why is it going like that? As the speed increases, you can see at the lower speeds, this vehicle speed, and this is power requirement. If you look at the power requirement would be very, very small like this for rolling resistance alone to overtake. But aerodynamic resistance, if you look at, it would be very less than the earlier. But there is a threshold speed, say around 80 kilometers per hour. You see that is going to go like that, shooting up. So at the higher speeds, you would have more power requirement to overcome an external forces that are acting on a vehicle, addition to rolling resistance, and because of your aerodynamic resistance. So this all sum, along with the accessories power requirement, all are put here. Additionally, you also have a reserve here because you are choosing your engine is operating not at this, also at a different speed. So the speed which is beyond the maximum speed corresponding to the maximum speed of the engine. So that is what is chosen. Right? So this graph, if I draw so clearly, it should be like limited by this. Look at till here. Let us erase this portion. So this is all my additional power requirement at particular speed. Say this is around 150 kilometers per hour. Kilometers per hour speed. By providing overdrive, I would be able to meet. So this is the 30% overdrive. This is 30% overdrive. 30% overdrive. So 30% overdrive was able to meet that with the reduction in the resource power of 36% only. Whereas I have here reserve power of 50%. So it is not that the entire power output of the engine has been utilized in overcoming. So in spite of overcoming all of that, I have this reserve power. Right? So this is all for a typical power requirement graph. And this is done for a top gear. That means what is that higher gear? This is written. At a higher gear only you require more power. And a higher gear you can have this overdrives. These are overdrives. Overdrives corresponding variation of power. Right? As function of speed. So this is all about power plant and transmission characteristics. We will see some case studies in the next class. And there are other transmission system like automatic CVT or hydrostatic transmission system. I leave it to you as a self-study from this. And the vehicle, whatever that you have chosen, what is the transmission system, all that you have to now collect the information and present in your digital assignment. So choose a passenger car and look at the complete detail, what type of transmission system is there. So you may have a same brand with the manual gears as well as an automatic gears or CVT employed. If it is an automatic gear, what is the specification of torque converter? Because torque converter is essential there in case of an automatic gears transmission system. So this is all something that you have to additionally provide in your digital assignment. And with that note, let me stop at this point, this lecture. And that is going to, that's covered the traction part of longitudinal dynamics and vehicle capability to achieve that maximum tractive effort against the two limiting factors that we have been discussing. So first period we discussed on the road adhesion coefficient and load, and the second period we looked at in detail the power plant and transmission characteristics. So the tractive effort that comes out of these two, whichever is smaller, is always going to decide the performance potential of your vehicle. So with that note, let me stop today's lecture. If you have any doubts, you can ask at the moment. Otherwise, we will disperse. Right? There are 63 students. I would download the attendance sheet. Any doubts?
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
So in that geometry configuration.
Yeah.
So how the operating range of engine is determined?
How the operating range is decided. So operating range is decided as based on, you cannot have any constant engine speed. There's always going to be a fluctuation, right? So you would have a range of speed maintained instead of maintaining a constant speed. Why? Because you want to suddenly accelerate or decelerate, you are driving your vehicle. So you are going to not always drive at a cruising speed, right? You're going to drive your vehicle, maybe suddenly you may have to, you can make a judgment that if I slow down a bit and then I can overcome that topic ahead instead of stopping or slowing down. Instead of putting full brake, I slightly reduce my speed that it can go. So when I want to reduce my speed, what am I doing? I am decelerating. When I decelerate, what's happening? Engine speed falls down, right? So my vehicle speed falls down. My engine speed also should not fall down so much. So I should maintain my engine speed range operation is in the same. So when I brake, what is happening? When I brake, my vehicle going to reduce the speed. When I drive, I tend to reduce my gears. Why I tend to reduce my gears? Because when I decelerate, my vehicle speed reduces. Is because the input that is given to the drive axle from the output of my gearbox is same. Unless and until I vary it, I cannot have my vehicle engine otherwise stall. The load will be more. Correct. So with a high speed, when I suddenly apply brake, my vehicle decelerate quickly. When vehicle decelerate quickly, engine cannot run at that high speed. I have to put my gears to the lower gear. So in this process, what is that I am doing? It is I have to always have my range of speed fixed, irrespective of my vehicle speed. So that would be obtained how? That would be obtained how? With the constant gear ratios of constant gear ratios. So I have my gearbox 1, 2, 3, 4 gear speed, 4 speed gearbox. So if I have my second gear ratio to first gear ratio, that is what zeta 2 by zeta 1, that ratio, or zeta 3 by zeta 2, that ratio, or zeta 4 by zeta 3, that ratio is constant. So how can I achieve that? I can achieve that when I make my engine to have same range of speed ratios, range of speed operation condition. That's possible. That's why you have to go in for other speed. Right? Do I have answered your question?
Yes.
Why do you have to have two speeds? In order to implement this geometric progression, to have an intermediate reduction ratios in the gearbox.
Yes, sir. Yes, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So what is this? So I can ask you this question in the examination, or anybody can ask you, okay, your manual transmission system, how the first gear and final gears are decided. So what is the basis of design of your gears? First, you go for the highest speed of your vehicle and decide your nth gear ratio of the n speed gearbox based on the maximum vehicle speed that is expected. Right, so maximum vehicle speed would be obtained when you have your maximum engine speed slightly more than that of the maximum power of the engine corresponding speed. Beyond that, I would have. So when I have that, I would have my vehicle speed maximum. So when I have my maximum vehicle speed, I will decide my drive axle ratio, considering a vehicle to be of direct drive vehicle or overdrive vehicle, according to the requirement of my vehicle. So overdrive vehicle means I would have that is kept there zeta n instead of 1 value, 1.3 value. I will get my drive axle gear ratio. After I get my drive axle gear ratio, then I will look at my lowest speed in my gearbox, that is first gear. So highest reduction possible at the first gear. So first gear, how is it decided? Maximum gradability of the vehicle is accounted there. So maximum gradability of the vehicle is accounted. I would be able to have it. And you have seen from the mathematical equation, you require a value of zeta axle. So zeta axle is obtained first, and that zeta axle you substitute there, and you get your gear ratio zeta 1 there. So once you have zeta 1 and zeta n, what is your KE factor? It is under root of n minus 1 to root of nth speed, zeta n by zeta 1. That's all. That's how the gearbox works. So intermediate gears to decide, you take your highest speed and then follow this pattern, what I have explained, with the fixed operating range of the engine speed and decide. And this is what is generally followed in case of commercial vehicle, but in the case of a passenger cars, it is not followed because of the reason that getting few intermediate speeds with the geometric progression has got a practical difficulty of having integer number of teeth in the gears. So for such reasons, you would have higher speeds would be closer compared to that of the lower speeds. So maybe second gear will be closer to first gear, and the third and fourth gear may be closer to fifth gear, something like that, right? So this is all that you have to understand. Any other doubts? Any other doubts, anybody? Anyone? You do not have doubts, then I will stop now. Stop recording.